all this is changing. So Walter spent, I don't know exactly how, that's maybe 6 years, 6, 7 years in, at Ohio State University when I was a professor there at the time.
Sorry about that. Yeah, so Walter spent around 6, 7 years at Ohio State. At the time I was a professor, this was the late 80s and early 90s. And he and his wife Ann bought a house just down the street from us, like half a block away. And our families became very good friends. And so we've been good friends ever since. But in addition to being good friends, Walter had a rather large influence on my career in a way I'm not even sure he's aware of. So this was, as I said, the late 80s, early 90s, and this is when the ideas behind geometric group theory first were just emerging. So there are two events that I remember from that time very, very clearly. And one was when Mike Davis came back, who was also a professor at Ohio State University, came back from a visit to Geneva, waving this preprint by this guy named Gromov that was full of these weird new ideas like hyperbolic groups and cat zero geometry. And Mike said, we have to read this preprint. And so we started this reading group to try and work through this preprint. The other event that happened around that time was Walter came back from a conference, I think here in New York, I'm not absolutely sure, talking about another strange idea, something called automaticity and bi-automaticity of groups. And after he gave a couple, a lecture or two on these ideas, I was having trouble getting my mind around what these concepts were. And I decided, well, I'll test them out on some groups I'd recently become interested in called Artin groups. Now, these are not right-angled Artin groups. They're what are called finite-type Artin groups, which are closely related to braid groups. And I thought, well, I'm just going to see if I can understand this concept in the context of these groups. And, well, let's just say the rest is history. First of all, I did write a paper on bi-automaticity of Artin groups. It turned out they were, and I wrote a paper. But I really, what happened is I got totally absorbed and addicted to Artin groups, geometric group theory, and all the ideas that came out of these two papers, and I've been doing this stuff ever since. So thank you, Mike, and thank you, Walter. All right, so I'm going to talk today about something about Artin groups, but in this case, right-angled Artin groups, and it's actually not the right-angled Artin groups themselves, which we have heard a lot about already, but automorphisms, automorphism groups of right-angled Artin groups is what the topic is here. And I know it's kind of late in the day, everybody's tired, so this is going to be kind of colloquial style, a lot of pictures, and I'm not going to try and do any proofs, just give you a picture of what's going on. So, all right, so let's get started. And I should say this is, it says it on the slide, but let me say it out loud. This is all joint work with Corey Bregman and Karen Vogtman. Okay, so first of all, let's just establish a little basic notation. What is a right-angled Artin group? We've seen these in various other talks earlier, yesterday and today. So we're going to start out with gamma being a finite simplicial graph with vertices V and edges E. And associated to this graph is a right-angled Artin group whose generators correspond to the vertices in the graph. So we have one generator, VI, for each vertex in the graph. And then two generators commute. We say two generators commute precisely when there's an edge connecting them. So the graph is really just a way of encoding this presentation. It's just an easy way to encode a presentation. And any group of that form with finite and many generators and just some of them commute, some of them don't, we don't care which do, which don't, is called a right-angled Artin group. Okay, so the other thing that's going to be important here is we're going to need a k-pi 1 space. We're going to be referring to a k-pi 1 space for these groups, and these are easy to construct. So we start by putting a loop down for each generator, for two generators that commute, we would want to glue on a torus between those two generators, which would make those two generators commute. And that already will give us the right fundamental group, but we want this to be a k pi 1 space, meaning we want its universal cover to be contractible. So we have to add some, fill in some more stuff. So whenever we have a collection of commuting generators, 3, 4, 5, however many that all commute with each other, we glue on a torus of that dimension to those generators. So those then become higher dimensional tori. And it's easy to show when you do this, that what you get is a locally cat zero cube complex. And so when you pass to the universal cover, it's globally cat zero, which means it's contractible. So it's automatically a K pi one space, okay? So these are very simple, very easy to construct. Here are a couple of examples. So throughout this talk, we're always going to start with the two extremes. So the two extremes of right-angled Artin groups are either the case where you have a discrete graph, no edges whatsoever, in which case the group is a free group, or at the other end, you have a complete graph, meaning every pair of generators is connected by an edge, in which case you have a free abelian group. Okay, so those are the two extremes. And then in between, you have all kinds of choices you could make, you know, other things. So in the two extremes, so we're starting here with the two extremes. We have the discrete graph case, so we just have a free group. And in that case, our K pi one space, I forgot to say what it was called. So we're going to be referring to this a lot. It's called the Salvetti complex, the K pi one space. The Salvetti complex in that case is just what's called the rows. It's just a bunch of loops with no higher dimension tori at all. Okay. At the other end, we have the case in which we have a complete graph. And so our group is now ZVN. And in that case, we just have a torus that glues everything together. And you're just an n-dimensional torus. And that's all it is, an n-torus, all right? So in between, we have all kinds of stuff. I've just given one example here where I took the example, this example. Here's my graph gamma. So I have four generators, A, B, C, D. A commutes with B, B commutes with C, C commutes with D, okay? It's just an arbitrary choice I made. So what's the Salvetti complex? Well, I put a loop for A, a loop for B, a loop for C, and I glue on three tori, one for AB, one for BC, and one for CD. Okay, so that's it. Okay, so that's the idea. And if you have, you know, higher dimensional stuff, you keep gluing, but in this case, I don't. So that's the Salvetti. Okay, so these are the objects I'm going to be playing with. All right, we've got our groups and our associated K pi 1 spaces. All right, so as I said, what I really want to do today is not really talk about the groups themselves, but the automorphism, or more precisely, the outer automorphisms of these groups. So remember, outer automorphism means you take the automorphism group and you divide out by the automorphisms given by conjugation by a single element called the inner automorphisms. Okay, so what are the two extremes? I mean, why do we want to look at these groups, all right? So, well, what are the two extremes, all right? At one end, we have the outer automorphism group of the free group, right, at the one extreme. And at the other extreme, we have the outer automorphism group of Z to the N, which is GLNZ, all right? Well, these are two highly studied, pretty well understood groups. And as we heard earlier in... Who's talk?
Martin Bryson.
Bryson's talk? Yeah. Well, yeah. So we have they also, we can include in this set of groups the mapping class groups are also similar. They're all similar. They're similar in many ways, and they're similar to mapping class groups. And there's lots of theory behind these things. So what we want to do is generalize that theory to outer automorphism groups of more general right-angled Artin groups, okay? So we want to understand all these groups that sit here between out of FN and out of GLNZ, all right? And sort of extend the theory to this whole span of groups. All right, so so I've been working on these questions off and on for many years. And at the beginning, I was working with Karen Boatman. We discovered you could do a lot of things just plain algebraically. You could show that if you had an outer automorphism, that certain it had to preserve the subgroup generated by certain subgraphs or certain quotient graphs, or, you know, we showed that there were subgroups, there were quotient groups, you know, which had to be preserved, and use that to deduce various sorts of algebraic properties. So we had a whole bunch of just sort of algebraic arguments to try and piece together things, you know, from the two ends and understand these middle things. And also there's some, then our work was extended a great deal by Day and Wade and various other people. So there are algebraic techniques. Okay, but I'm a geometric group theorist. And I like geometric techniques. So one of the big things that techniques that have been used to understand these other groups, the like out FM, are actions on some nice space. So we want to study the group by finding a nice space of some sort on which it acts, and using that space to deduce properties of the group. All right. So our goal in this project that I'm talking about today is to develop so here's our goal, develop geometric tools to study these groups. Okay, that's what we're trying to do. Okay, so what do we mean by this? So at the two ends, we have some well-known spaces on which these groups act. So let's start with the free abelian case, because people are more familiar with that. So we have a natural action of GLNZ on what's called the homogeneous space. And I'll be talking more in more detail about that in a little while. So the homogeneous space is GLNR modulo the orthogonal group. So you have a right action of the orthogonal group and a left action of GLNZ on this space. Okay, I'll discuss this in more detail in a few minutes. Okay, at the other end we have an action of the out of FN of the free group on something called color and Votant space, which has come to be known as outer space, color and Votant's outer space, all right? And that action has been used to understand a lot about these groups. It's played a large role in our understanding of the groups. So what's our goal? So I should say something about this. There's an important fact about both of these actions at either end. The spaces they act on are contractible, and the actions are very nice. They have their proper actions. They have finite point stabilizers. They're really very nice actions. And those two properties are essential in using these spaces to derive properties of the group. Okay, so what we're looking for is what goes in between. So what are we looking for? Well, we're looking for out of a right angled arc group acting on, well, what? That's the question. You know, what can we construct? A nice space with a nice action about a gamma, all right? To sit, you know, that sort of gets us from one side of this picture to the other side. Okay, everybody understand that? That's my goal. That's what I want to talk about today. And that's what we've been working on, right? Okay, so what should this space be? Well, we'd like it to be a nice contractible space. With a proper, or at least a very nice action of some sort of out of a gamma. And the idea is we need to understand the picture at the left side and the right side and see if we can merge these into something that works across the whole spectrum. All right, that's what we're gonna do. So let's give a little space here. So how are we gonna do that? Well, let's start at the two ends and understand what the spaces at the two extremes look like. And then we'll try to merge those into space that makes sense for everything. Okay, so let's start with the abelian case. I don't know why I chose to go that way first, but we're gonna start with the abelian case. So in this case, out of A gamma, so A gamma is Z to the N, and out of A gamma is GLNZ, yeah, okay? So, and the Salvetti complex in this case, I'll come back to that, but the Salvetti complex is a single n torus. It's just an n-dimensional torus. That's all it is. All right. Okay, so I said that in this case, the action you're interested in is the action of GLNZ on homogeneous space. But I want to think of homogeneous space now, not as a space of matrices, but as a space of metric tori. All right, so this is a standard way of describing points in homogeneous space. So if you have GL and Z, if you have GL and R, so now I'm looking at this guy. So if I have GL and R, we can think of the columns as giving us a basis, yeah, for Rn. So I have this basis. I've drawn the two-dimensional case over on the right here because that's all I can draw. So I have this basis. I've chosen these two elements, and I can think about the torus generated by those. Well, I think about the parallelotope or parallelogram, whatever you call it, generated by those basis elements, and then turn it into a torus. So I glue opposite sides to each other, this side to this side, this side to this side, right? And what that gives me is a torus with a particular metric on it. It gives me a metric torus, okay? So, and notice that the action of the orthogonal group, that just like rotates this around. It's not gonna change that torus, right? It's that metric torus is gonna be the same no matter what. So I wanna think of a point in this homogeneous space as a metric, what's called a flat metric on the torus. But it has a little more information, namely it has a choice of two basis vectors, which is called a marking. One way of describing this choice of vectors is it's a choice of isomorphism between the fundamental group of this torus and Z to the N. We've chosen N generators for the fundamental group, okay? Okay, so that's how we're gonna think of these points, as a metric torus together with a marking on this metric torus. And if we think of it this way, then the action of GL and Z on this space is just changes the marking. We just compose this given marking with a homeomorphism of Z to the N to Z to the N is our new marking. You know, so given an element of GL and Z, we just get a new marking, okay? All right, so there we have it. That's how we want to think of this case, all right? Metric tori with marking. Okay, so yeah.
Is it the same as choosing a fundamental domain in Rn for your
lowest? Yeah, you can describe it that way. Well, except it has to be a nice fundamental domain. Yeah, I mean, it has to be at least a linear, yes, yeah. So now let's, I want to think about this space. Look at one other property of this space. Right, let's start with a very simple metric torus, nice orthogonal thing with my choice of basis vectors is it's orthogonal AB, no problem. We're just gonna start with that example, okay? And now I want to look at what happens when I change the marking, okay? What does that mean? I wanna do this in pictures now, changing the marking, okay? So instead of A and B, so here's my change of marking. So remember a change of marking I do some isomorphism here. Well, here's my isomorphism I wanna do. It's something called a transvection. I want to take A to A and B to B times A, all right? So when I do that, I'm really got the same torus. I've just chosen a different set of vectors. I've just chosen a different set of basis vectors, right? Well, wait a minute. I could instead think of this as a new torus where the shaded green part is the torus generated by my new basis vectors, right? Yeah? Well, the point is they're the same torus because if I just slice this open here and move this side back to this side, I've got my original torus. They're the same metric torus. All right, so whether I think of this as choosing a different basis or choosing a different metric, I mean, it's the same torus with a different marking, but I can think of it in either way, okay? So does everybody see what I'm talking about? Okay, all right, now I'm trying to construct I have one in this case. This space that I'm acting on is contractible. In particular, it's connected. So there has to be a way for me to walk from this picture to this picture in this space, right? I have to be able to gradually transition from the left side to the right side. So how do I do that? Well, I'm trying to get B to go from being orthogonal to being diagonal, right? So why don't we just push it a little bit at a time? Push, 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 push until it gets onto the other side. All right, so let me see if I can draw. Let me see if I can draw this picture. So I want, no, actually, I should, yeah. do this. Yeah, so, you know, go all the way. This way. You know, and I push it a little to the right, and then a little later I push it a little more to the right. This is my B. And then a little later I push a little more to the right. And I keep sort of skewing. What I'm doing is gradually skewing this torus. All right. As I move from here to here, I'm gradually, you know, doing this to the B, right? Yes? Okay. Okay. So the point is, when I do that, if I fill these in, I discover at these intermediate stages that I no longer have the same metric torus. All right. At every stage, I have a torus, a metric torus, but they're no longer the same. They are at both ends, but they're not in the middle. And you can easily see that, by the way, by taking something like take something orthogonal to orthogonal to the, oh, that was not what I wanted. What just happened there? The wrong one. Okay, if I take some, just start going orthogonally. If I do that here, I just come out at the same point when I reach the top, right? Yep, I go once across and I'm done. But if I do that here, oops, I ended up here. And now I'm gonna come out here, and oops, now I'm gonna come out here. And I keep going and going and going. For all I know, I make that forever with that, you know, not come back the same place. I've definitely changed the metric. It is not the same metric tour. All right. So that's all I want to note. Need to change the metric. All right, so even though at the two ends they were the identical torus with just the marking change, to move from one to the other, you need to allow me to change the metric on the torus. Okay, yeah, question?
With the area or the volume of all the tori is the same.
Is
there the same reason?
Yeah, I think so, but I don't care about that. And the area is irrelevant for my, not, you know, that's not my concern. I just care what the, you know, whether the metrics stay the same. Okay, so I'm just saying that even though to define the action does not change the metric, but getting from one to the next requires me to change the metric. There's no way to get there if I can't change the metric. Okay, all right, so let's move on. Okay, got that picture in your head? Good. Okay, so let's do the other end. Let's start at the other end and try and do a similar thing. Okay, the other end, we're starting with, instead of a torus, we're starting with a rose, a wedge of circles. That's our Salvetti complex. That's our fundamental, our K pi one space, all right? So this space is called color Boatman outer space. I'm gonna tell you what it consists of, okay? So again, I start with something which is has fundamental group, the group I'm interested in, which is the free group, and a marking. A marking meaning an isomorphism of the fundamental group. So theta. I've jumped ahead. Let's start. So I'm going to actually, as you'll see, I'm going to allow for more general graphs in a minute. But let's start with the rows. Let's start with something simple. We'll start with the rows, and we have a marking. All right, a marking meaning I've chosen an isomorphism of the fundamental group with my free group. All right, so I've chosen one, you know, which loop is A, which loop is B, et cetera. And now I want to try and do that same thing as before. I want to take B goes to BA, so this loop is no longer B, it's now BA. And I want to say, how could I continuously move from this picture on the left to this picture on the right? All right, so that's going to tell us what we need to allow for here. All right, well, the way you do that is by something called a folding. So we want B to not just go around B anymore. We want it to go around B and A. We want the loop that used to just go around to B to now go around both B and A. All right, so I'm going to do that gradually by, I'm going to keep my A here, but now I'm going to gradually fold B onto A. And I'll fold it some more, and I'll fold it some more. So as I move, again, as I move from here to here, I'm going to fold it farther and farther on until it's folded all the way around. So going around B now takes me both on the B part and around the A part. It might, maybe that would have stayed in first. I may have put this around backwards. But anyway, it's a process called folding. Or, by the way, another way of showing it is instead of starting at the rows and folding, we could go the other way around. We could start with the graph in the middle and collapse something to get either to the left, to the right. To get to the left, I would collapse this, and I would get this picture on the left. To get to the right, I would collapse this, and I would end up with the picture on the left. All right, so you can either think of them as the graph still has fundamental group, the free group, but it's a little more complicated graph, but it has ways I can collapse it back onto my original graphs, okay? So that's the way to think of that. So it turns out this is what Keller and Boltman's outer space is made up of. It's made up of graphs. They are metric graphs, so the edges have lengths. So it's made up of metric graphs together with a choice of isomorphism of the graph with the free group, and moving around the color and Boltman space just means you can think of it as either folding or collapsing is how we move around in this space, okay? All right, so the key thing to keep in mind here is, that we needed, in order to make this work, it wasn't so much an issue of the metric, we actually needed to change the combinatorial structure of the graph. We need to actually introduce a new combinatorial structure. So it's not just a matter of a metric changing. We're actually changing the object we're looking at combinatorially. Okay? So you have a question?
I don't forget what the fold is. Is it a pad or is the
The marking? Are you asking?
Intermediate one.
The marking on the intermediate. It's a choice of, yeah. I mean, drawing it this way is hard to. It's a choice of isomorphism of the fundamental group of this with pi one. So with F two. I see what you're saying. Yes, you can just do it by a collapse and followed by G in this case. Yeah, you can always do it by collapsing something and then followed by G. But when you get all the way around, there's no collapse anymore. I mean, there's nothing to collapse anymore. So now you've got a new marking. You've actually changed the marking. Okay. All right. So they can all be done by collapses followed by isomorphisms of the rows. All right. So the idea is let me move on here. So the idea is to merge these two constructions. So the thing to keep in mind is on the one hand, we needed to change, we had tori and we need to change the metric on the tori by skewing them. And on the other hand, we had some combinatorial structure and we need to actually adjust the combinatorial structure by doing like fold, some kind of folding, okay? All right, so what we're gonna do is try to merge these two constructions when we're starting with an arbitrary right angled Artin group, all right? And we're gonna have to somehow merge these two constructions. All right, so, and to do that, we're going to need to modify both the combinatorial structure and the metric, okay? All right, so let's start building we want to build an outer space for an arbitrary right-angled Artin group. So I need to give you a little bit more background on automorphisms of right-angled Artin groups. So we're going to need to know a little bit about a generating set. We don't need a lot of detail, so in the interest of time, I'm not going to talk about every one of these. There's a well-known generating set due to Laurence and Servatius, And the two that are going to matter to us in this talk are numbers 4 and 5, the transvections. So I'm just going to, the others are simple to describe, but they're not important to this talk. So what I care about is are these last two, and they are exactly what I've been drawing pictures of, where you take two generators, say A and B, and you send, say B goes to B times A or A times B, either way around. And everything else is fixed, you know, and all the other generators are fixed. So that's called a transvection. But I need to divide these into two different pots. Namely, it could be that A and B don't commute, that they generate a free group. There's no edge between them, in which case they're going to look like a free group transvection. Or it could be that they do commute, in which case it's going to look like one of those GLNZ transvections, right? I mean, both pictures I drew were B goes to BA, that's what they were, but they acted differently according to whether B commuted with A or B didn't commute with A. So we call these folds or twists according to whether they do or don't commute, all right? So it turns out that if you restrict your attention to all of the generators except the twists, so get rid of those skewing things and look at everything else, allow anything else except that, then the subgroup you get, which I'm calling U gamma, the untwisted automorphism group, really behaves an awful lot like out of a free group. It turns out that most of the kind of stuff you do with free groups can be pushed forward and we can think about them that way. So that's in fact what we did first. And this was actually quite some time ago. I don't know how many years ago now, the paper came out in 2017. And this was joint work with Vogt and a former student of mine, Nate Sandbaugh. We constructed an outer space just for this subgroup. We didn't allow for the twists because we didn't know how to deal with them at the time. Okay, so let's just look at what that looks like. Okay, so now what's going on? Well, I'm going to do a really simple example, but it really shows you already what you have to do. Okay, so let's just take the case where we have a free group on A and B, direct product with another generator with a Z by another generator C. So C commutes with A and B, but A and B don't commute with each other. Okay, just simple example. What's the Salvetti look like? Complex look like? Well, it turns out in this case, the Salvetti complex is the rows for the A and B cross a circle for C, right? Well, what does that look like? It looks like two tori, an AC torus and a BC torus, and they intersect in a curve. Okay, so that's my here's my Salvetti. All right, two tori joined together in a curve. All right, and now I want to do B goes to BA. What do I have to do? Well, I could just use what I did before and just remember that I have to cross the whole thing with C. I mean, supposing I just did what I did before, that folding I did before, but I cross it all with C. Well, what does that look like now? Well, now it looks like I'm folding one torus onto another. All right, so I'm just doing foldings again, but now I'm folding entire, if you want, cubes onto each other. They're cubes, some of which have been glued into tori, which get folded onto each other instead of just a graph getting folded, okay? So it's just a folding process again. And the way to really make this precise is the collapsing process. I said you could either think of these as folding or you could think of them as collapsing. So the way we actually define these things, what we call these things in the middle are gamma complexes, and we define them in terms of collapsing. So a gamma complex is a locally cat zero cube complex, formed by folding S gamma, but as I said, that's not very precise. So here's a better way of saying it, such that we can collapse a collection of hyperplanes to get a, give, gives, there's a collection of hyperplanes that can be collapsed so that the collapsing map is a homotopy equivalence back onto the Salvetti complex. All right, what do I mean by the collapsing map? All right, well, what's a hyperplane? So in a cube complex, there are these, it has zero cube complexes, there are these things called hyperplanes, which hopefully a lot of you have seen. You take what's called the midpoint of a cube and you extend it to the midplane of the cube, extend it to the midplane of the next cube and the next cube and the next cube, et cetera. And you get this thing called a hyperplane, made up of these midplanes of the cubes. What do I mean by hyperplane collapse? It's not actually the hyperplane I'm collapsing, it's the edges dual to the hyperplane. So what I'm gonna do is take all the edges dual to the hyperplane, which are these red edges, yes, these red edges, and I'm gonna smash them down to points, meaning I'm gonna take what's called the carrier of the hyperplane, the cubes that carry the hyperplane, and smash them onto the hyperplane, all right? The hyperplane doesn't change. It's the stuff around it that gets smashed onto it. Okay, so I've drawn you a picture here. What happens if I collapse this, quote unquote, this hyperplane? I've drawn H here. It means what I'm actually doing is collapsing the dual edges. Okay, everybody see that? So what you want is that there's a collection of hyperplanes such that collapsing these is a homotopy equivalence down onto the original Salvetti complex. And that's by definition what a gamma complex is. All right, that's the actually easiest definition. Okay, so our outer space consists of, so I call the this outer space we defined, this was the original outer space for the untwisted automorphism group. We call it K gamma, and the points consist of a pair X, rho, where X is one of these gamma complexes, all right, one of these things I just described, and rho is, I'm only allowed untwisted automorphisms. So what do I mean by that? Well, what I actually mean is that rho is either just one of these collapses I just talked about, which is a homotopy equivalence, or one of these collapses composed with an untwisted automorphism, all right? I only allow untwisted automorphisms, so composed with one of these untwisted automorphisms of the fundamental, all right? So, okay, so it turns out this thing was what we were looking for. We proved that K gamma is a contractible space with a proper action of the untwisted automorphism. So this was back in 2015, all right? This was a space we were looking for in the case of the untwisted group. Okay, that left, so everybody kind of get this? We just want to do the same thing that we did with graphs, but now do them with cube complexes instead. All right. Okay. But yeah.
In your pair is gamma rho. Is rho, should we be thinking of rho as the marking?
Yeah, it's a marking, but it's only an but we're only allowing these untwisted. The problem was, what do we mean by we're only allowing untwisted mark? We're not allowing any old isomorphism with it. Has to be of untwisted type, meaning it's a collapse followed by an untwisted. Okay. And that's what we need to fix now. I mean, we don't want to restrict that. We want to include the twist. Yeah. Okay. So step two, and this is the Bregman and Boatman, the more recent work, is how do we allow for twist transfections? Okay. What do we do to allow for twist transfections? Okay. So the idea is we are going to start with the same gamma complexes. So these cat zero cube complex, local cat zero cube complexes, whose fundamental groups is our right angled arc group. Same thing. But we have to allow the tori to twist, right? There's only, we can't avoid allowing these tori to somehow skew, yeah? Because that's how we did the twists in the ZVN case, all right? So we said, okay, let's do it. Let's allow them to skew, but we have to be a little careful how we allow them to skew. We don't want to skew just individual cubes, because if you just have like a something like a picture like this, and if you were to skew a single cube, say this one, so that this angle got smaller, it wouldn't be cat zero anymore. It wouldn't be lovely cat zero, and you'd lose control of everything, blah, 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 blah. Anyway, so we don't do that. We skew entire hyperplanes, which means we take a hyperplane like this, for example, and push the whole hyperplane up. Every cube that has that hyperplane gets pushed along, right? And it turns out then this does work. Turns out you do get locally cat zero things. We're going to again get locally cat zero complexes, but now they're going to be made up of parallelotopes instead of cubes. Yeah, we're going to allow for parallelotopes. All right. Okay. You know, so that's good news, because we can kind of see now we get to skew things like we needed to do. And so we define a space, which I'll call T gamma, which is now the X and the rho are the same things they were before, essentially. I mean, the X is again a gamma complex, just like it was before. And the rho is Actually, we only allow, for right now, we're still only allowing untwisted. I'll come to that in a minute, what we're gonna do. Because the twisting happens by doing this, all right? As opposed to by the marking, all right? So this F means that we're going to now allow for different metrics on the cubes. They're now parallel tubes instead of cubes. So F describes the parallel tub structure on the cubes. And there are some rules about, you know, this a whole hyperplane's have to see. You know, there's some rules. But basically, it's one of these complexes with certain skewings allowed. Okay. All right. Unfortunately, we thought, we got it. This is going to be our outer space. Unfortunately, we couldn't quite figure out how the action of the whole out A gamma worked, because the untwisted part was acting on this, and the twisted part was acting on this, and they weren't playing nicely together. I mean, the problem is that untwisted is not normal in the whole group, and there was no canonical way of lifting it. They just weren't playing nicely together. I mean, it was sort of all happening, but there wasn't a well-defined action, okay? So why? Well, the reason is that if you look at even the GLNZ case, are we supposed to, let's go all the way back for a second. Are we supposed to view this as the same torus with a different marking, or is a different, it's now a parallel cup structure. It's no longer what it used to be. It used to be a cube. I've changed the metric. So if I did this in new notation, there would be that F would have changed. You know, should I view it as a change in F, or should I do it as a change in the marking, not in F? All right, and you need to equate those. It doesn't work unless you equate those two things as being the same operation, okay? So the solution, it turned out, so we didn't get stuck. We just had, you know, we're trying to figure out how to deal with this fact that they didn't quite work together. So the twist transvections change F, but they don't change rho. And we need, it turned out that the solution was to remember the metric on the gamma complex, but not the precise division into parallelograms. That is, we want to view the entire gamma complex as a metric space, and remember the metric on the entire gamma complex, but we're not going to remember what every shape of every decomposition looks like. All right, we need to forget some information in order to make this work. All right, so I'm going to draw you a picture in a minute, but we define a slightly different version of this that turns out to be the outer space we needed, which is again a gamma complex, just like it was before. But now, instead of remembering an exact structure, parallelotope structure on it, we only remember the metric on the whole space. It comes with a metric. So if two parallelotope structures give the isometric spaces, then they're the same there, okay? And we're now allowed any marking whatsoever. We no longer have to restrict ourselves to untwisted. We're allowed any homotopy equivalents whatsoever. All right, so just to see what's going on here, let me give you an example of why this matters about forgetting, you know, just remembering the metric, okay? So what is involved in the proof later. So let's say we have, here's an example. So we have A and B commute, and C now is completely disjoint from them. It doesn't commute with either one, okay? All right, so the Salvetti complex is a torus to wedge a circle. All right, we have a torus and a circle. So, you know, I want to look at a gamma complex where all I've done is fold the circle onto the torus a little bit. So I'm drawing the torus as A and B. It's just a standard torus, okay? But I folded C a little way onto this torus. All right, I'm allowed to do that. I'm allowed to fold it. But if I fold it, there's this point, this vertex right here. This point where C emanates. So in order for this to be a CAD0Q complex, I have to subdivide that torus so that becomes a vertex. All right, I'm forced to subdivide. I'm forced to put a vertex there, okay? So, well, but I have a choice of ways to do that. Let's, you know, I could do the obvious thing, right? I could certainly do this. Yeah? Okay? But I could also decide to skew these. There's two hyperplanes here. There's a hyperplane up here. Well, there's more than two, but these are the two I care about. What if I skewed one to the right and the other to the left? So they end up, you know, starting and ending at the same place, but I skewed them a little, all right? So I skewed them, and now if I do that, in order for this to be a vertex, the only way I can make this into parallelotopes would be to do something like this. Yeah, now that's a parallelotope structure. And now I keep skewing a little more, and I'm skewing a little more, and eventually I skew so far that I don't need to subdivide. It already is a vertex. Why subdivide? Because I've actually skewed it to the point where this thing is a vertex anyway. All right. Well, it turns out that all of these are in fact the same metric torus. They all give the same metric space. They're just different parallelotope decompositions of exactly the same space. All right. So these all represent the same point in our new outer space, whereas they were definitely different points in our first version, where we remembered every parallelotope, right? We've forgotten all this information, and we're just remembering the overall picture, okay? Where we don't care how it's composed. Okay, that also tells you how we got it. What's our point? We claim this thing is contractible. So how are we gonna prove that? And this is the key to keep in mind here. Okay, so the theorem says that this is contractible, and I'm pretty sure the action's proper, but all we actually prove is that it has finite point stabilizers. It's a nice action. Yeah, I didn't actually prove it's proper, but we will. So it has a nice action of the entire A gamma. Okay, so what's the proof? I'm gonna finish early here. Okay. Because I'm not going to tell you much about anything about the proof. So what is the proof? All right, so we constructed, let me go back and talk about, review what we did here. So this first thing, which you've probably forgotten about by now, this was outer space. Let me actually write this on here. This guy was outer space, was the outer space we first constructed for the untwisted automorphism group. So I said we constructed an outer space for untwisted automorphism group. No skewing, just folding. Yes? Okay. That was a theorem back from 2015 or whatever with Boatman and Stamba, where we proved that one was contractible. Okay, so we know that one's contractible. All right. The next thing we did was to introduce skewing. That's this stuff, where we put in this script F that tells us exactly the shape of each parallelotope. Well, there's an obvious map, it turns out, a very simple map from here down to here, namely unskew. Just take every parallelotope and, you know, and straighten it. All right, turns out you can do that, it works. And by the way, there's a map this way too, which I didn't write here, which is just keep them all orthogonal. Don't skew anything. Just keep them all orthogonal. So we have a map from, the map from here to here, and it turns out that one it is a deformation retract, and it turns out easy to show. It turns out that this straightening process just retracts you back onto back down to here, and it's fairly straightforward. Okay, to show those two were homotopy equivalent. Okay, and the markings are the same. The markings that are allowed on those two are just the untwisted. So that part was pretty easy. All right. So the problem was this second process. So the second process was we had to forget the actual parallelotope structures and just remember the overall metric. So remember that? So the key thing was that all of these things now become the same when we map from here to here, all right? We forget a lot of information, All right. So the main part of the proof was to show that this forgetful map, this map that forgets the parallelogram structure and just remembers the metric, is surjective. That's not obvious because we've allowed more markings down here. It's not immediately obvious that it's surjective, but it is because now the skewing and the marking play nicely together. All right, so the first thing was to show it's subjective. And the second was to show that it's a, oh, I didn't write this down. It's a vibration. It's a, well, it's not a vibration actually. It's a, but it's homotopy vibration. It has some contractible fibers that to really understand what we lose at each stage. All right, and to show that all of those fibers are contractible. All right, so that's the hard part. That was where that's the main, the whole crux of the proof is well, first the construction of space, but then the proof that the fibers are contractible. And it was a little non-trivial to show that it was subjective, but not that difficult. I'm gonna end early, which is a good thing for last talk today. What's next? So at the moment we've just finished, you know, the paper we wrote is and it's going to appear, you know, it's just the construction, it's just the proof of that theorem, basically. It's construction proof of that theorem. And of course, what we'd like to do then is to use this to, you know, you look at all the things that color and vote and space are used for and what people do with it. And, you know, you want to do something similar for these in this more general context. So there's all kinds of things you might do next. So these are all known for out FN. You know, and you want to do something similar more generally is a constructive bordification to compactify this space, to study the dynamics of the action of an automorphism. You know, can you classify, you know, are there sort of pseudo Anosovs, and, you know, to study the dynamics of the actions of individual elements on this thing. There's now a metric called the Lipschitz metric on color and vote in space, which has turned out to be useful for all kinds of interesting things people have been doing with it. So is there a nice metric on this space? So there are a ton of questions out there now. Is can you do for this outer space what people have done for color vote in space? One more I threw on here because this is the one we happen to be working on right now, is the Nielsen realization theorem. So what does Nielsen realization say? Well, originally this is for mapping class groups on acting on surfaces, but you can do it for out FN or now we want to do it for our space, is given a finite subgroup of your group, in our case out a gamma, does it fix a point in this space? So in mapping class groups, you're given a finite subgroup of the mapping class group, you want it to fix a point in the Teichmuller space, meaning fix a hyperbolic metric on a surface. And that's the classical Nielsen realization. So it actually acts on this surface by isometries. Do we have a Nielsen realization? Once again, what we've been working on is starting with the untwisted. Same thing. Start do it for untwisted first, and then see if you can extend it. I mean, we're going through the same process basically. It turns out that Hensel and Kielak had done a kind of a Nielsen realization for the untwisted automorphism group, where they constructed some kind of complex that this finite group acted on. But we needed to show that the complex they construct is actually one of the points in our outer space, because we have a very specific set of complexes that are in our outer space. So the first process was to see that we could use their construction to actually find a point in our outer space that was fixed by H. And it isn't all written up, but we think we've done that. We think we're still writing it up. And then of course, we're just now getting started thinking about the next step. How do we incorporate the twist subgroup? And which is the interesting part, but you know, but that was, That's the idea. So anyway, so that's really all I was going to say. Thank you, everyone, especially Walter. And
so I have a silly question. So you work very hard to get this beautiful space that has two really important properties. One, that it's contractible, and two, that your group acts on it properly, morally.
We hope, yeah.
But yeah, let's say more. If you only wanted to say get one of these properties, is there sort of a cheap way to do it? Like for instance, if I look at the space of all cat zero metric spaces, homotopic to my space together with a homotopy equivalence, is there sort of a cheap reason why that's contractible?
So it's possible. I don't know. You're absolutely right that we did have other considerations. So for example, with outer space, you want to make it as low dimensional as possible because you want to get bounds on the virtual cohomological dimension, and you know. So you're trying to sort of minimize. It's true that even in the first construction, when we were just working with the untwisted, we first said, well, what if we just have all complexes? And then we said, no, we don't want to do that. It's too huge. I mean, it's just out of control big. And we felt like it wasn't going to give us anything useful. So I don't actually know if it's contractible or not. I'd have to think about that. But we did have other considerations in mind about using this to, you know, for things like BCDs. And, you know, so we were trying to limit ourselves to things that we could control and that wouldn't be too high dimensional. So it's a reasonable question. I don't know. You just allow for anything, but it.
The only reason I ask is that maybe there is a sort of a cheap construction of a sort of silly big space that has one property. Your space would sit in a very natural way. And then maybe there's some interesting way you argue that the big space has some nice deformation.
It's an interesting idea. I mean, ideally, of course, you'd like also co-compact, which you can't do, but you can try to build compactifications, which or bordifications, which then give you, you know, co-compact. You know, so we wanted to have some control, but yeah, I don't know. It's possible. We didn't think about it. Yeah.
Thank you. You know what the virtual promo?
Well, so it turns out in the end that was done pretty much all computed algebraically. That's a day and weight. We did some of that in our original paper. Karen and I were able to do it in some cases, and day and weight basically extended that to pretty much everything. So we do know, it turns out we do know that, and that was possible to do algebraically using these subgroup and quotient group things. So not using this.
What does the dimension of this outer space end up being? And are there any low dimensional examples that you can draw a cool picture of?
Good question. Maybe just, well,
I mean. For out F2, there's this kind of spiky disk thing.
Right. Interesting to draw the picture for us. Out of two. Yeah, you do know that you can say something about dimension because you do have some control over the dimension in the U gamma direction. And then you also we have very explicit descriptions of the fibers, so you can figure out the dimension of those. And you know, so you first compute the dimension of the in this picture here, essentially. You can compute the dimension that you just go through this process and you compute the dimension of fibers and you can could do it. I mean, but it's not the right bound. I mean, even in just the U gamma case, it turns out not to be, it can in some cases be bigger than the virtual cohomological dimension. That's an example with Karen Boatman and, oh, the student of hers, I've forgotten his name now. They have an example where the dimension of this K gamma is bigger than the VCD. Not much, but it's not quite, doesn't quite give the right thing. So you can compute the dimensions, but as I said, since we already knew the virtual cohomological, and we mostly haven't, I mean, but it would be doable. We have the information that will allow you to do that, so. Yeah.
So one of your questions was about metrics. So I mean, there's obviously these kind of instructions getting nice metrics on the outer space, like the normal outer space. If you sort of assume your graph is connected, you get rid of some of those issues. So are there nice metrics then? Analog, technical metric.
You know, we have not, I threw that in as a, hey, this would be a cool thing to do next. I have not thought at all about how to get metrics. I mean, it'd be an interesting thing to talk about, but you mean metric on the outer space.
Yeah, I can metric on outer space, but like under some hypothesis, it gets rid of like the,
that would be fine. Yeah, I'd be happy to restrict to connected. Although, you have disconnected some things in there. You can't always get rid of it entirely in some sense, you know what I mean? Because they exist. Interesting. I honestly haven't thought at all about how to come up with a metric. I'm just thinking, oh, what do people play with on you know, for out FM? And, you know, that would be the next questions. But I'd be interested in talking about ideas for that.
One more question, so it's time to speak again.